Gifts that God has given us, and that is His Spirit and the glory that and the glory of all of who He is.
I'd rather have Jesus than have I'd rather have Jesus than anything. What a beautiful, beautiful song. And may that truly be our prayer. May that truly be our heart's desire this morning. You know, we're continuing our study in the book of Haggai and looking at priorities and the, just the different themes and the texts that are in this passage. This is a short prophetic book, only two chapters, but it's packed full of all kinds of things that we will see. And if we left the children of Israel, we left last week, and they were down and out because they just kind of quit. They quit rebuilding the temple that God had called them to. And then through the word that came to Haggai to the people, he said, now rise, basically. Go build. Do what you're supposed to do, because I'm with you. And what an amazing promise that is. And so we pick up in chapter 2. So go ahead and turn your Bibles to chapter 2 of Haggai in your pew Bible, a Bible app, whatever you got with you. And let's follow along in the Word of God with us today. It says now in verse 1, in the seventh month, on the 21st of the month, the word of the Lord came by Haggai the prophet, saying, speak now to Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest, and to the remnant of the people, saying, who is left among you who saw this temple in its former glory? And how do you see it now? In comparison with it, is this not in your eyes as nothing? So, let's stop. So, between verse 15 in chapter 1 and verse 1 in chapter 2, we're looking at practically a month has passed. And even after 4 weeks, the work had slowed down on the temple. They were getting discouraged once again. Because what we see here is because what was happening is as they were building this temple, they're realizing this isn't glorious. This isn't what it used to be in the old days. In fact, in the book of Ezra, it talks about this scene too, and it says the old men wept because they had seen Solomon's temple. And it just seemed to them that this temple was just inadequate. It was just inadequate, and they felt horrible that they weren't giving God what he deserved. And so the grief was still felt. So in the light of this, what was God's message to the people? In the midst of the people's comparison of Zerubbabel's temple with Solomon's temple, the Lord did have a specific message, which we will get to. And the timing is extremely significant because in light of the full revelation of Jesus Christ that we will see. See, what's interesting is that this message came to Haggai, to the people, during the Feast of the Tabernacles. Now, what's the Feast of the Tabernacles? The Feast of the Tabernacles was the time where the people of Israel, the people of God, would come together and they would celebrate God's provision for them in the wilderness and his deliverance for them out of Egypt. Specifically, what? Through manna and through fresh living water. Now, we've looked at this and it says that this message came, what, on verse 1? On the 21st day of the seventh month. That's basically, as you go back, that's October 17th, 520 B.C. We got it down to that date. And this is not just the first day of the tabernacle. This is the last day of the Feast of the Tabernacles. And hold on with me just a few minutes. You'll see this, why this is so important. Because this is the day that they ultimately celebrated all of God's provision in their life, and they cried out to God for his presence and for his mercy and for his protection in their life and in their nation. Now, we need to understand this from a historical context, that the people in Haggai's day, this was a time that was absolutely essential, because we're talking about their wilderness past. And the Lord wanted to remind them, even in this moment, even when they're down and out, that they wanted to give up. He wanted them to see beyond their present circumstance and beyond their limitations to the bigger plans and promises of God would have for them in the future. And so as we see this message, and so you see that they're asking questions, and this temple's nothing like what it used to be. And then watch what God says. Look in verse 4 and then in verse 5. He says, "Yet now be strong, Zerubbabel, says the Lord, and be strong, Joshua, son of Jehozadak, the high priest, and be strong, all you people of the land." He says it three times. He says us to be strong. So many times when we feel like we're failures, we feel like we want to give up, we don't want to persevere, we throw in the towel. And it's in those times that God first says to us, "I want you to be strong." Because not out of your own strength, I will give you the strength to be strong in this time, in your time of need. And then God says this. He tells him to be strong. And then he says, "And work, for I am with you, says the Lord of hosts." I'm going to give you the strength. I want you to be strong. Now go and do your work. Be obedient. Be faithful unto me. Why? Because I am with you always. Reminds them once again, my presence is with you. I love you. Do you trust me? Do you trust me in this work that I have for you right now? Because I'm going to show you amazing things. So he says, "I am with you." And then verse 5, he says, "According to the word that I covenanted with you when you came out of Egypt, so my spirit remains among you." And then lastly, he gives another, "Do not fear. Be strong. Do your work. I am with you. Do not fear, because my spirit is among you." Should that not encourage us today? He says the same thing to you and I. He tells us to be strong. He tells us that I am with you. He tells us to trust me. He tells us, do not fear, because my spirit is in you. And I care for you. And I love you. See, for the task they faced, the Lord promised his presence once again, reminding them of the promise he made when they came out of Egypt. And his presence would go with them and be in their midst, and there would be no fear. When those children came out of Egypt, they were led by a pillar of a cloud and a pillar of fire to symbolize God's leading and presence in their life during this time as they wandered in the wilderness, where they did not know exactly what was going on or where they were going. They knew they were headed to some kind of promised land, but they had never seen that. But they had to trust. They had to trust in their God who had just delivered them. And he says the same thing to you and I. Follow me. Trust me. In my presence and in my provision. This must be a priority in your life. And so, this is where it gets really cool. All right? I want you to hold in Haggai. And I want you to turn over to John chapter 7. John chapter 7. Starting in verse 37. 38 and 39. Now watch this. On the last day, that great day of the feast. Jesus stood and cried out, "If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water." But this he spoke concerning the Spirit, whom those believing in him would receive, for the Holy Spirit was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. You see, what Jesus has said here, what he did and what he said on this day, over 500 years later from Haggai, is worthy to take notes. Because these events that are recorded in the Gospel of John occurred on the Feast of the Tabernacles. And they occurred on the last day of the Feast of the Tabernacles. And they occurred in the same temple that was built by Zerubbabel. This is the same temple that is standing over 500 years later. And this is the same event where people celebrated this feast as they celebrated then as they did in Haggai's day, of remembering God's presence and provision in the wilderness. And it was also a reminder of the blessing of the coming Messiah for them. So Jesus here, he cries out to any who are thirsty, for he knew the deepest needs of every woman and man alive. And they, you and I, could have their thirst quenched if they would only come to him who is the living water. Now we need to know and understand what was happening, like, visibly as Jesus was saying this. So during this Feast of the Tabernacles, at the first part of the day, each day, 7 days, this would take place. The high priest would walk down to the Pool of Siloam. The Pool of Siloam had lots of significance there. We won't have time to get into that. But it was also a place where you also see in Scripture where it was thought that the waters would be stirred and people would get healed. The Pool of Siloam. So he would go down to the Pool of Siloam and he would have a golden pitcher in his hand. That was part of the temple. Part of the altar where they would do sacrifices. And he would dip it into the Pool of Siloam. And then he would head back through the south gate. The water was known as the water gate. Back to the altar. And there would be a procession at this time. And they would walk around the altar. Now, each day there would be different burnt sacrifices and a sin offering. I mean, throw that in there. But as they walked around, there would be a couple things happening. There would be a sounding of trumpets 3 times. Then the temple choir would sing. They would sing psalms. Actually, specifically Psalms 113 to 118. And the high priest then would take, after the morning sacrifice, would take this pitcher and would pour it symbolically at the altar. Now have that vision in your head. Because then it says, on the last day of the great feast, that same routine would happen. But then they would march around the altar, procession around seven times. And the priest would chant Psalm 118, verse 25, and it says this, "Say now, I pray, O Lord. O Lord, I pray. Send now prosperity." In this place, on this same day, over 500 years earlier, Haggai had assured the people of God's presence and provision for the God-given tasks that had for them. Now fast forward over 500 years into the future. Jesus cries out, "If any person thirsts," as he sees the high priest pour the water out of the pitcher. He looks at those around him in this temple and he says, "If anyone thirsts, let them come to me and drink." And Jesus' promise to those who believed in him was living water, the life and fruits of the Spirit, the forever presence and provision of the Spirit of God himself. He says that to us. Are you thirsty this morning? He says that to the non-believer and to the believer alike. To the non-believer, he says, "Come and drink of me, and I will give you life. That water, my water, can only give. My sacrifice on that altar in that temple, I will have a much greater sacrifice. And my water will flow out of me." And to the Christian, in a way, he still says, "Drink of me. Let me be your presence. Let me be your provision. Drink from me. O weary pilgrim, the long and hard road that you have or you feel right now, I am with you. Do not fear. Drink from me. If you're hurting, you're in pain, you're terrorized by your past, you're scared of the future, he says, drink from me." Just come drink. Be strong. Because I love you. Oh, what amazing things. Our God is for us. As we go back to Haggai, we see this in verse 6. He says, "For this day, the Lord of hosts, for thus says the Lord of hosts, once more, it is a little while, I will shake heaven and earth, the sea and dry land, and I will shake all nations, and they will come to the desire of all nations, and I will fill this temple with glory, says the Lord of hosts. The silver is mine, and the gold is mine, says the Lord of hosts. And look at this, the glory of this latter temple shall be greater than the former. And in this place, I will give peace, says the Lord." See, the words of the Lord imply that the silver and gold of the nations, don't worry about how this will be built. I know it takes money. That it will come to the house of the Lord in Jerusalem, and the glory of this house will be greater than ever. And has ever been witnessed before. He says there in verse 9 that there will be God-given peace and that no nations threatening or warring against Jerusalem or Israel in any way, I will be with you. God is saying to them, Misas Tuas. It's this word. It's this word of that God is seeking to encourage, to strengthen, and to give them a confident hope in His plans for them. In His plans for you and I. And maybe you sit here today and you think, I don't know, Jonathan. I know the former of me. And I kind of know who I am now. But God is saying, I'm going to make you great in the sense that when I abide in you and you abide in me and you have my living spirit inside of you, I will transform your life in a way that you never imagined. And I will use you for my kingdom. And people see the love and the grace of God in your life. And you may be in hindrance and think, oh, there's no way I can do this. There's no way that pain can be healed. Because no, I will make all things new. I will bring triumph out of tragedy. And people will see my glory and my grace in you. Says to the people in Haggai's day, this temple, this place of my presence, will be greater than is ever known before. My prayer, maybe our individual prayers, and even as a prayer of our church, should be, may the glory of God dwell in this place greater than it's ever been seen before. And may we seek that with all of our heart, and be faithful and obedient to Him. You see, church, all God ever wants is to reveal Himself to a responsive creation who would turn love, who would in turn love Him with all their heart, mind, soul, and strength, and reflect Him to others throughout the world. And you see, God continually works at getting our attention. And it's through His prevenient grace, His grace that goes before us, His grace that woos us, His grace that convicts us, who wants to bring us to Himself. He relentlessly pursues us with passion to love because He loves us. And He wants that relationship. And He continually teaches us about Himself and about how He wants us to live in Him. God especially wants us to learn how to experience Him as our life. He wants us to live in and through us, showing us His character, His truth, His love, and His goodness. And God wants us to continually experience His presence and His provision. So the question that we must ask ourselves this morning, will we make His provision and presence a priority in our lives? Or another way to say it, as I've said before in different messages, will we truly trust His heart for us? Will we truly trust His heart for us? Amen. Let's pray. Father, may that truly be our prayer. That we would truly trust You with our entire being. That we would make Your presence in our life, and that we would seek Your presence, and through that we would see Your provision in just magnificent ways. God, we thank You for Your love and Your grace. And I pray that we would, through Your help, be disciples of you that will show your light into this world. In your name I pray.
What truth? If you would stand with us as we sing of Christ being the solid rock, which we place our firm foundation.
Thank you for being here at Mount View and our church family. Welcome you back. And we just want to pray this blessing and benediction over you. Father, I thank you for your provision, Lord God, and your presence in our lives. And I pray that you would go with this group, this church family, these disciples of you. And I pray that we would go forth by your strength, and that we would be strong, and that we would do the work that you have us to do because you're with us. Your Spirit indwells us, and you tell us, do not fear. Amen.